So what I'd like to do is this talk is, so I'm going to discuss this experiment. So it was an announcement by Google about a year ago, quantum supremacy. On this particular, I'm going to discuss this claim that they have in the abstract that they have made a task. And if you want to do the same task on a classical computer, it would take 10,000 of years on the biggest one. So biggest one, they are talking about Oak Ridge, a million core supercomputer. So a million core, 10,000 years. And they do it in 200 seconds. And so it was a big news. I mean, it was everywhere in France. Even in Grenoble, we have a particularly bad journal called Dauphiné Libéré. And even there was actually a paper on quantum supremacy. So I want to quite briefly discuss what is the claim exactly. I won't bother you with the physics aspect, really more what is the claim in terms of what they have done, really. What I think it brings, it brings actually a lot to the field. And then, so that will be say a third of the talk. And then the two third, I will discuss what we have done in terms of algorithms, simulations, to try to see if we could break this 10,000 of years on million core and do something maybe better, do it in maybe a better way. So that's really how I'm going to split the talk. Once again, yeah, so you have to understand that even these things that it might look like physics to me, but even for me, this is computer science already. Yes, it's what I really do usually. I work in quantum nanoelectronics, so we're talking about millikelvins. We are doing physics essentially. So there might be a lot of glitch. And so if you don't understand something, just stop me and I try to see if we can find a common language. So. So I have a very short introduction before I get into this supremacy thing. So the question everybody is asking in the field, and it's a totally relevant question, is what can a quantum computer be good at? I mean, what can we do if we get them? What's the hook? Actually, why is Macron giving 2 billion euro to do this? On this, it's a question. Actually, the target has been shifting quite a lot with time. I mean, if you look at the initial target, it was actually things. Let me go. You can get a laser pointer. Here we are. I mean, initial target was essentially Shor algorithm, for instance. So cases where you could get an exponential speed up. On cases where you could get an exponential speed up, yes, essentially factorizing big numbers or quantum chemistry, these kind of things. But people realized, it took some time, but people realized that even with quantum error correction on very good qubits, this is a very, very far away target. And so very, very far away targets are not good to get grant money, so you need to find closer ones. And so now people are more focusing on sampling problems. So now you give up on the idea that, so here I call it quasi-deterministic. So it's, of course, quantum computer always give you something which is random. But for some algorithm, you can make it such a way that the probability to get a given answer is almost one, which means that essentially it's deterministic for all practical purposes, which is what you want to call a calculation. You know, you ask a question, you get the answer. Now the shifting towards sampling problems. So problem where you essentially get random numbers, but these random numbers can be used to calculate averages of things that can be actually used for use cases, for instance, also for, so it can be used, for instance, for also for quantum chemistry or for some optimization problems. These are the two main things that people are trying to do. Okay, so these people are looking at that. It's actually, of course, the existence of a speedup is now not clear. Probably it won't be exponential if there is a speedup. It might be just a speedup because it's faster, because you make dedicated hardware for some problem. So might be just faster, but not parametrically faster than a classical computer. The useful use cases are still very, very far. So it's not clear how far, but depends on how optimistic you are, but they are very far. And then you might want to do nothing much, but faster than a classical computer. And that will be the subject of today, the quantum supremacy. And there are also other aspects which I think are very interesting, and I will try to put them on the next graph. Like quantum simulation. So here it's not, you're not per se doing calculations. So you guys maybe are not so interested in the sense that you don't have algorithms really. But you can still use this this quantum state to get a lot of information on other quantum states. Essentially, use the ideas to mimic a quantum state with another. And maybe that's actually can be very useful in practice. They are not very useful at the moment, but they are very advanced, and it might become useful eventually. And then there are things like D-Wave, and I won't even talk about that because it pissed me off. So to try to, so you have all these claims, and I had a question before we started the talk about boson clamping, sampling, and you have all these claims by all these groups, and they all are best, they're all the best. So I try to organize all these claims in a three-dimensional graph, where I put here difficulty to simulate, that's one axis. So yes, you, whatever you do, you want it to be difficult to simulate, because if it's not difficult to simulate, then some computer scientist with a classical computer might just do it better than you. And since we have already classical computers, then it's really a necessary condition. It's not sufficient, but it's necessary. Another axis is universality. So how programmable is your thing? Can it do only one thing, or can you actually use it for tons of different things? And then the third axis is usefulness. So actually, can it do things that are actually interesting that you will want? Or it just does things, okay, that are maybe universal or difficult to simulate, but we don't care about the output. So if you try to place things on this, I'd say most groups are doing stuff with quantum computers now. It's not so difficult to simulate because they don't have so many qubits on the, but they are keeping it quite universal. So they have a universal set of gates and so on. Google, they gave up totally of the use on the usefulness. I mean, what you will see, but it's actually totally useless. This experiment, in terms of you cannot do anything with it. It's also slightly less universal. They had to give up a little bit on universality to be able to do this experiment. And to answer the question about boson sampling, that maybe it's more difficult to simulate, although this remains to be proven. But it's also much less universal than Google. And so, so there's a use. Interesting equals zero plane is this quantum supremacy, and on the universality small, I would say, is a quantum simulation realm where you don't have a, you can't do a lot of different things with your simulation. Essentially, you can simulate quantum systems. On the other hand, they are not so very far from doing things that are actually useful. And then you, if you improve on all three axes a lot, you get the universal quantum computer. Okay, so that's it for the introduction. And now let me start on this quantum supremacy per se. So this is a chip of Google. And the best thing you will see about the chip is this picture, because actually we have no idea of the layout. And for you, maybe you don't care, but we physicists do care, and we are very pissed that we cannot know actually what they did. Actually, we have no idea what they did. And the cartoon is this. So each cross is a quantum bit, and it can interact with its neighbor through this square, blue square here. And the very important new thing here is that they managed to have a to build a coupler, which is somehow itself some sort of qubit, which can be actually turned off and on. That's very, very important, because when you have many qubits, if all the interactions are on at all time, there's no way you can actually control this. That was actually the, in terms of engineering, that was the new thing that make this experiment possible. And so the experiment is essentially what I would call a system validation. Is that you can measure qubits, one qubit, you can measure two qubits, two qubit gates. And really the idea here is now we are going to use 54 qubits. And the question is, can we actually make these four qubits work the way they are supposed to work, right? And so for that, the circuit that you are going to use doesn't really matter. So they use a circuit which is essentially random. But by random, don't imagine that it's really random. Just imagine that it's the structure doesn't matter. You just pick one circuit. And you pick the circuit that you can give the most entanglement the quickest. You want to build entanglement as quickly as possible, because you know that decoherence will kill you eventually. So you have to be very, very quick in building the entangled state. So this is a circuit. Essentially, you see the in red here correspond to two qubit gates. So first you have you put one qubit gate on each qubit. And then you apply the red one, so it's corresponding to this interactions here. And then you do the light green, which corresponds to the next column. And then the purple and so on. And when you have finished with the sequence, you continue. And they have tried to build up a sequence which make it as difficult as possible to be simulated on a quantum computer, on a classical computer. So you start from all qubits in state zero. You apply a bunch of unitary matrices, and you get your state psi. essentially from a mathematical point of view, this is just matrix vector multiplication. So here, x, I use it x as a short for possibilities for all these qubits. So it's essentially a string of 53 zero and ones. And so the state you get at the end is a superposition of all 52 to the power 53 possibilities with some amplitude psi x. And the probability to get one of this this string x is just the square of this amplitude. That's quantum mechanics for you. Okay, so the rules are clear. So the first remark I would like to make is that so they are going to repeat their experiment a million times. So the output of the experiment is a million bit string. So you have a million of strings, each of them contain 53 zero and ones. Okay, that's what you have. Supposingly distributed according to a distribution P of X, which has been engineered by your circuit. First thing I want to know is that to notice is that they are about to 2 to the 53, that's about 10 to the 16. So you have, if you want to make an histogram of this distribution, you have 10 to the 16 bins and you have only a million samples. So you have one hit every million bin. So there is no way you can make an histogram. And there is no way you can calculate correlation functions or things like that neither, because the circuit that you chose is random. So that actually there is no structure anywhere. So the only way you can make sense of your data is by actually taking a classical computer and calculate the P of X that you should have got and see whether it makes sense to say that these guys that you got are actually distributed according to what you should have got. So it's called quantum supremacy, but you actually need a classical computer to get any output from this experiment. So in some sense, it doesn't answer any question without a classical computer, any question, even a dumb one without a classical computer. So this is a fidelity measure that they have cooked up. It's called coarse entropy benchmarking. It's not the best fidelity measure that you can think of, but actually it's one that they can compute. So that's the good thing about it. Essentially, you want to compute the correlation, so the sum over all bit string, correlation between the distribution that you should have got, P of X, and the one that you actually got, times some normalization factor. On this, you can compute because essentially, since you have samples of Q of X, this is approximately given by the average of these samples of P of X of I. Okay, so this has, so what this is actually what they compute in practice. So once again, it doesn't answer any question if you don't have a classical computer. So that sounds supremacy is maybe a bit of a stretch using this word. It requires a classical calculation, and it's still exponentially hard. Because this number will actually decay exponentially with the depth of the circuit or with the number of qubits. Therefore, you need to also increase exponentially the number of samples that you have in order to get an error bar smaller than your actually signal. So it's still exponentially hard. So that's the data. So this is this cross entropy benchmarking as a function of number of qubits for different type of circuits. And the reason they have different types of circuits is that some of them are actually simpler to simulate than others. So that you can actually, you will be able to continue the simulation of those circuits even when you cannot simulate the hard one, the red one. And you see, and that's the most important thing about this experiment, the fidelity decays exponentially with the number of qubits, and the fidelity decays exponentially with the depth of the circuit, the number of cycles or different layers that you apply to your circuit. Essentially, that's important fact. Everything decays exponentially. Everything that you can call a fidelity with decays exponentially in these things. But it's the first time it's actually been measured on something else than one or two qubits. So it's the first time people have actually done a full system validation. And even though it is exponentially decaying, it is still big enough that you can actually measure it and with an error bar small enough that you can say there is a little bit of quantumness left in my system. It's not purely random, a little bit left of quantumness. So that's a big, and I put it in big, and I would have put it bigger if I had a bigger screen. That's something you should remember. The fidelity, the actual many body fidelity is a fidelity, let's say per gate or per two qubit gate or per one qubit gate or per everything to the power of the number of times you apply this. So let's say number of two-qubit gates to the power of the total number of two-qubit gates. And that's essentially the number of qubits times the depth for this sequence over two. Don't really matter. So they managed to get a big F of one part over 1,000. So that it means that it doesn't look impressive like that, but it's actually quite impressive. So it depends, again, the story about the glass of wine, half empty or half half full. So there is 999 part, which is full random, and one part over 1,000, which is correspond to this quantum state. And they have applied something like 430 gates, which means that the effective two qubit gate fidelity that you have, the small f, is 98.6%. If you put all the errors into that, which is not true in practice, but it doesn't matter for my purpose too. Well, that's what you should remember about this experiment. And this is for physicists, so we just skip it. Okay, so now I turn to the second part. And I want now to look at this claim. So now we know what they have done. And they claim that doing so would take 10,000 years on a million core computer. So I have a counterclaim that I'd like to do today. And I think that their claim is probably more or less correct. I mean, you must have seen that IBM said, no, it will take only 2 days. And but their claim is more or less correct. If by that you mean simulating the perfect state, if you want to get the perfect state, it's actually exponentially difficult and it would take a large amount of time. And IBM maybe could do it in 2 days, but if you just add one more qubit, then you don't have enough memory, and then you have to go back to the algorithm that Google used, and then you're back to 10,000 of years. So I don't want to argue about whether it's 10,000 or 100,000 or it's a lot of computing power. So my claim is that they don't have a 100% fidelity, they have 0.1% fidelity. So big F was only one part over 1,000. And my claim is that if we use, essentially, I'm going to show you some algorithm that we borrowed, I borrowed from many body physics. I think the best word for them that I use now is quantum state compression. So it's a, and I use this word because it's very analogous to what you do when you do image compression. So I'm going to do the calculation, but I'm going to throw away information, carefully monitoring what I'm throwing away, so that I throw away exactly the same amount as what Google threw away. So I have the same fidelity at the end. And in return for this compression, we get an exponential speedup. So in that sense, we are transferring the difficulty from number of qubit or depth to the fidelity. So my algorithm will be exponentially difficult in fidelity, but linear in depth on the number of qubits. And then the question is, how far can I go? Can I reach the fidelities of quantum computers or of the next generation? Or, I mean, so somehow this approach can be used to get an idea of the real computing power of a real device, in the sense that I put in front a classical algorithm that I would say try to race on the fair way. We are comparing same things. So for a given level of fidelity, for a given quality of quantum state, that's the amount of classical resources that I require. So it's a much better comparison point with hardware than just this 10,000 of years, which according to me doesn't make any sort of sense. So now we can turn to mathematics, and that's you should be now more in your in your area of expertise. So okay, just to introduce my notation. So I'm going to use tensors. On the beauty about tensors is that you stop writing equations, you just make drawings. So this is a vector, so essentially that's going to be a circle with one leg. A matrix has two legs, a tensor with three legs, and so on and so forth. And so when I want to have to write a tensor contraction between these two guys here and there, I just essentially connect the line of the matrix to the line of the three-leg tensors. And every line in between two tensors, you suppose implicitly that you are summing up. So now, and that's the language that I'm going to use for everything. So now in this language, that's essentially the Google experiment in 1D, that's a 1D version. You start with everyone in state zero. Then you apply two qubit gates. And then one qubit gate. So I put different colors because they are essentially random. And you continue like that. And at the end, you get a tensor with many indices, as many as qubits. So this guy has 2 to the n entries. And the question is how to compute this thing. And the reason why it's actually exponentially complicated to do this exactly is because, well, this tensor has exponentially large number of states inside. Okay, so it's a large vector. So we are doing matrix vector multiplication on a very, very large vector. And that's very difficult. So I'm just going to tell you how we're going to do that using algorithms. They are called D-emergy in physics. Density matrix emergential group. There is a whole cloud of algorithms known as tensor networks, matrix product states. It all started with D-emergy with Steve White. I hope he will get the Nobel Prize for one day, because this guy essentially many problems that were totally inaccessible before are now possible because of this development. And now with the development with MPS and tensor networks, this is actually spreading to all kinds of problems, much beyond the physics problems that we used to look at. So the tool I'm going to use also is a singular value decomposition. So I have a big tensor here. And what we do is we group part of the index to create row. Other parts, we group it to create a column. So now it's a matrix. You can do a singular value decomposition. And you get a unitary matrix times the diagonal matrix times another unitary matrix. So you get this. And the nice thing about singular value decomposition is that you can sort your singular values. And you get a good low rank approximation of your matrix if you just take the big ones, right? And that's essentially what I'm going to do. I'm going to throw away the small ones. I'm going to register very carefully what I throw away, because from that, I can calculate the fidelity of my calculation without knowing the exact states I'm referring to. That's very important for practical simulations. Because if otherwise I could only do it for small numbers, and then I would be like Google, needing a classical computer to get any output from my code. But I can calculate this fidelity, and that's actually a very important part of it's technical, but it's actually crucial. Our next slide is the same thing seen by physicists in terms of entanglement and things, but probably for you it's actually better to see it like that. But if I keep only one singular value, I have what is called a product state, so which means zero entanglement, and if I keep two and so on. So I'm going to truncate we don't need this slide. And we don't need this slide either about entanglement entropy. So that's the algorithm. I start from my initial state, which has the form of, we call it a matrix product state. I think in computer science, it's called tensor train. So essentially, I have decoupled my initial tensor by SVD. Actually, the initial one was a product state, so I didn't have to do any approximation for that. And then I apply a two-qubit gate. And each time I apply a two-qubit gate, here, this is a zoom on this part. So I can make the contraction here. I have this guy. And then I do SVD. And then I truncate. And then I absorb this diagonal part, let's say, to the left. And I'm back to something that looked like MPS. So I have this way, I have a way to compute at a linear cost. It's linear, but it's going to be, of course, it's linear, but of course, the cost of the calculation depends on the bound dimension here, chi. So it's scaled as a chi cube. And the question now, it's really experimental, I've been doing numerics. What is the kind of fidelity that I can get with this approach?
Sorry. Is there some kind of interpretation of this guy? Like, if you look at the simulation, the original setup of quantum computer that you want to simulate?
No. It has no interpretation with it's really a mathematical tool. It has interpretation in the sense that if chi equal one, then you can have only product states. Chi equal two, you can have more entangled states. And so chi really captures the amount of entanglement that you can get. And essentially, that's the slide I didn't show you, but the amount of entanglement entropy, maximum entanglement entropy that you can get in a state is directly bounded by chi.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, so essentially we do the simulation and we get an approximate matrix product state, and now I'm going to show you the experimental and the numerical data. Everything I do for the moment is for 1D. I will show you some data on the actual Google chip at the very end. So this is the kind of plot that I can make. So fidelity as a function of the number of layers, so the depth of the circuit. So initially I have fidelity which is perfect because I can have my bond dimension is sufficient to accommodate whatever entanglement I have in my system, and eventually start to decay exponentially. And here I have two calculations. One is the points correspond to the output of the code where I really calculate the fidelity by monitoring how much singular values I threw away. On the line correspond to a direct calculation where we really calculated the overlap between the exact states on the approximate state, and we check that it's actually the same thing. I have almost a mathematical proof that it's the same thing, but you can build counter example. But I would say so you can build counter example, but in practice, it's very, very difficult to build them. So with probability one, what we calculate is the fidelity, let's say. I will skip. So this is a typical fidelity as a function of the depth. And so now I just extract to the slope if you want. And again, it's one for small depth. And then it goes down. And the surprise here is that it goes down to levels that are actually fairly high. And here, typically 99%. And what do you want to compare this with? You want to compare this with what we have in experiments. And so you saw the Google could do 98.6, essentially at the end of the. And so you can see more, sometimes you see 99.5, but you never see more on more than a couple of qubits. And so best you can see is 99.9 maybe on one qubit or two qubits. And again, as I was saying before the start of the talk, so your qubit, when you see very, very, very nice fidelities, are also the ones that you don't want to try to scale to more to larger systems for many reasons.
Sorry, and this fidelity indicates why? Because are you losing fidelity because you are trying to simulate the Google experiment and their fidelities, or just because like this is the best that you can do with your method, like the most singular values that you can keep with your method?
No, here, this is chi equals 64. I think we went up to 1,000 or so. So it decays with, so here it's perfect initially, and then it goes quickly to a plateau once you have essentially built enough. Actually, it will become clear why it goes to a plateau a bit later. And now if I study this, so this fidelity, as a function of this bond dimension. So it decays, but if you really take the thermodynamic limit, so very, very large depth on very large number of qubits, on here 240, that's the biggest simulation I did, but actually you can extrapolate to infinity. I kept the number here because just to show that we could do a simulation with 240 qubits, which if you take the Google algorithm, it would take it's not 10,000 of years. It would take the age of the universe to do 240 qubits with a depth of 200. So we can do that and still regain the fidelity close to 99% in 1D. Yet you see here there is a plateau. It doesn't seem it doesn't increase, and it's not going to increase as long as chi is much smaller. I mean, remains polynomially big, so it's much smaller than exponential. The exponentially large chi that I would need to get the perfect simulation. The way you go to the perfect simulation is actually not by improving this fidelity, but the tensors on the extremities become exact. And as you increase chi, more and more of these tensors become exact until they meet the middle. But the fidelity of the what you do in the middle is always at this level. And to understand it, we did what I call random tensor theory. That's because in my old days when I was young, I was doing random matrix theory and it's very close. So essentially, what is the worst case scenario for this algorithm? Suppose that we are essentially applying all kinds of random matrices to these guys. So at some point, the idea that, okay, what we, probably what we get here as a tensor after some depth is something which is not so far from random. So I did a very simple calculation. I took this tensor to be actually random, these two tensors to be random. Then I apply my algorithm, because actually the algorithm only depends on what happens here, not on the rest. And I calculate the fidelity. And I also calculate the distribution of singular values that I get. And the distribution of singular values that I get is the dashed line here. And here, these different curves correspond to different value of chi, up to 1,600. And you see that essentially the distribution I observe in the simulation is very close to this random tensor theory. Right? So essentially I get something is random, which gives me some sort of upper bound to the fidelity I can hope to get in this simulation for a tensor in the middle. And the tensor on the right of the boundaries eventually become exact, and at some point everybody become exact. But that doesn't do for me. I mean, I want to keep an algorithm which is linear in N on the D as a fixed chi. A fixed chi. So yeah, the idea is to use a fixed chi so that we can if I can simulate, I want to be able to simulate 200 or 1,000 qubits, not just a few. Okay, so now we need to find an algorithm that actually lifts this difficulty. And also, I want to show you some data on 2D of the actual Sycamore chip, because it seems that it's the only thing that people care for. And so for that, there will be two improvements on the algorithm. First one is grouping. And that solves two problems with one stone. That's pretty good. So I will essentially now consider a matrix product state where I group qubits in one tensor. So this tensor has four qubits. This tensor has four qubits. In this case, they all have four qubits. And that's pretty good. So for two reasons. First, so actually you see, I will use this grouping here. I group all the qubits on one column. That's called 1-1-1-1-1-1-1 grouping. Here I put two columns, 2-2-2-2-2 grouping. Here 4-2-2-4 grouping, and so on and so forth. So there are many ways I could group these things. So good thing is that it allows me not to do real 2D. So actually I'm going to keep my 1D code. It's quasi 1D now, but that's good enough for the Sycamore chip because they only have five qubits per. So now this algorithm is actually exponential in the number of qubits per column, but still linear in the number of columns. So I can still have many, many qubits if I take something very long, but if I want to make it wide, then probably I have to at some point to write a real 2D code. And there are real 2D code called PEPs and so on. So, but they are much more complicated to implement. And there were so many questions to answer before that we didn't go directly in this direction. So that's the first idea. It's also good in the sense that now many two-qubit gate will be perfect. Because for instance, if I apply a two-qubit gate between these two guys here, I have a perfect fidelity. Which means that even though maybe I don't improve the fidelity of some gates, I will have less and less and less gates that actually that have a finite fidelity. So the overall fidelity of the calculation will improve. So that's the first idea. And then there will be a second idea, which I call split and merge. And the second idea is to say, okay, maybe what we can do is we can try to do things in such a way that we apply many, many gates before doing approximations. And so and we do that using the split and merge technique. So for instance, I will have a first grouping like that. And then you see if I apply the red gates, actually I make no mistake at all. So I can apply one entire layer without making any approximation. And then I will do my SVD to go from this grouping to that grouping. So then I do approximation. And now I can apply the purple layer, for instance, and I make no approximation at all. So this way I allow from some compensation. I have, I still make approximation, but even less than I used to. And now I can show you the data. So these data are already 1 year old. We have better ones now, but I'm going to mention them very, very quickly. So this is what we could get without the split and merge, actually, with just the first algorithm. If we do the Google circuit with a control Z, control Z gate or control node gate. On there, on my laptop, the very one I'm using right now for this presentation, I could get a fidelity better than the one of Google. Okay, at a linear cost, again, once again, at a linear cost in the number of qubits on depth. So if you come back with, oh, but now we have 100 qubits, okay, if you just stack them at the end, I can still do the simulation, it will just take twice as much time. Okay, so very important. What matters is the fidelity for this approach, not. On the other hand, Google, they didn't use control Z. And they didn't use control Z for several reasons. One of them is that they could not, I think I also said that briefly before starting the talk. When they try to use control Z, the fidelity goes down quite a lot, and they can only use very, very few qubits, like 18th, I think they used in the last paper. So they could not. And also, control Z has only two singular values, two non-zero singular values. So actually, it's not the gate that is creating the most entanglement. So what they did is they used some sort of complicated gate with a combination of I-swap and control phase. And actually, not only they use this gate, called it F-SIM, but they even optimize it for every pair of qubits. And in that sense, they lost a lot of universality to get to this supremacy. On the other hand, they make my life much harder, because now to simulate this, it's actually much harder. So now I use this split and merge. If not, the fidelity gets really bad. And 1 year ago, we could only go to, again on this laptop, 95% fidelity. That's what I could get. I could get 95% fidelity. And then we tried two ways. One was to brute force the thing and say, okay, maybe we can use something bigger than a laptop. And that was a work done by Thomas Herald. I think I saw his name on the, so maybe he's following the talk. So Thomas essentially optimized, wrote a version of the code to use OpenMP so that we could use about 100 cores. And he has a very nice machine with a lot of RAM. So he could go brute force to about 97%. Yeah, I think it's more 97, so it's actually him. But not beyond. Also because at 97%, he was hitting a plateau, probably pretty much the same kind of plateau that we see when we increase the bound dimension in 1D. So 97% is not enough to claim that we have done exactly the same as Google. So now we are developing new kind of algorithms, smarter, and I have only one point here. So very small calculation. This is a 3 minutes calculation. No, this is 1 hour calculation on the laptop. But with a much smarter algorithm, now we really do things the way we should have done things directly. So we gain about a 0.5. And so now we are going to use the combination of brute force on the smarter algorithm. And who knows, maybe we can get there and actually beat them. So this we will know in a couple of weeks or maybe a couple of months. I would say it doesn't really matter. It doesn't really matter. What is pretty sure is that for instance, I checked with Google, we already have points that according to them would have, according to the algorithm that they use, would have taken, let's say 10 years, 100 years with a million cores that we could get on a laptop. And in that sense, it means that they were really comparing carrots with oranges. And also the fact that something is very difficult to simulate, well, okay, of course, you want it somehow. I mean, if you want to build a computer, you want it to do something faster than the classical one. But once again, it's not the only parameter. And if you give away too much for that, in particular, if you, in terms of universality, then I'm not sure that you are doing something so impressive. And once again, for instance, I see Michel Ferrero in the room. So Michel is an expert in simulating many body systems. And he knows that systems that are difficult to simulate, we have a lot of them. And it's not difficult to find. So that's essentially the end. I have one conclusion and then one epilogue. So bear with me, don't stop after the conclusion. There's one slide after that. So the conclusion, just summarizing what I said. So whatever else may be said, it's a very impressive experiment. These guys have the best quantum computer on the market, even though, that's a fact, I would say. So there are not a thing about this quantum supremacy claim that should be taken with a grain of salt. So, So it's still exponential scaling. It doesn't answer any question. There's this question of dark errors, which I didn't mention, but might be very interesting. There is part of the error that they see that it cannot account for. I mean, we have a lot of possible and probable sources, but it would be very interesting actually if there were errors that show up as a global system that you cannot see as an individual one or two qubit system. It might be, I mean, it's not very clear from the data to come. Yeah, separation for simulation isn't clear. Once again, I mean by that they have to give up on universality. Effective computing power is extremely unclear, and I think that this thousand of years on the classical computer message should not be taken seriously. And we are working to see how far we can push this sort of algorithm. So now my epilogue, and then I will be really done. I want to go back to this law, you know, the exponential decay of the fidelity, and it's a very important law. And so just to show you that with this law and with knowing almost nothing about Shor algorithm, you can predict how badly it will fail for actual quantum computers. So the only thing you know about Shor, two things. So the idea is, okay, let's use a noisy quantum computer and try to factorize big numbers with it. And it might be not so idiot, not so stupid, because even if we have, even if the probability to get the correct result is bad, we can very easily verify it, just about multiplying numbers, and so we can easily verify it. So it's okay to have many attempts before we find the correct result. So the only thing you need to know is the number of two-qubit gates that you have in the Shor algorithm, and actually is dominated by the classical part of the algorithm, and that scale as n cubed. With a prefactor, and I am asking some friends, so they, I hope to get the prefactor. I was hoping to get it today, but I didn't. But it's of order one, probably something like 10 or something. Let's take it to be one. Now the fidelity decays exponentially with the number of two-qubit gate, which means that essentially it decays exponentially with epsilon. So epsilon is one minus so it's really the error rate, one minus the fidelity per times a n cube. So that's on the fidelity happens to be, in the case of Shor algorithm, it's actually the probability for success of a Shor calculation, because it's the overlap of the state with the one you are looking for. And here you are looking for a deterministic state which gives you the actual result with probability one. So in this case, the probability for success in one try is actually f, which means that the probability of success after n trials. Okay, I won't explain where this formula from. I hope you can find. So the number of trials that you need is 1 over f. So it exponentially grows as exponential epsilon a n cube. Now, if you want, I have this, what I call the utterly uselessness threshold. So you compare this number of trials that you need with, okay, what if you try the number one by one? When I'm not an expert in factorizing big numbers, I'm pretty sure you can do better than that. But if you compare this average number of guys with square root of 2 to the power n, okay, you stop at square root of the number because you're done, but not that done. And then you get the threshold. And the threshold is essentially square root of 1 over the error rate per 2-qubit gate. And now if you put numbers for a 99% fidelity, quantum computer, you can essentially factorize a number with 1 or 2 bits. After that, it's better to actually try the numbers one by one. And if you want to go to 10 bits, then you need to multiply to divide your error rate by a factor 100. So you need to go from 99% to 99.99%. And that's mean decades of work for us physicists. I mean, you don't care, but we do. And if you get to go to 100, then it's another 2 digits of improvement in the fidelity. And this is the reason it's low is very important. I mean, from this law alone, you can understand a lot about the probability of success of different algorithms, and so it should be used. And it's a very important result of Google to have established this law experimentally, even though it's difficult to imagine that we could have gotten something else. Yet, I think we should give them credit for that. And with this, I will stop and I thank you a lot for your attention.